Daria Sorokina. I'm an applied scientist on the Amazon Search Relevance team. And I'm going to give you an overview of the algorithms we use for ranking products. Amazon is huge. There were more than a quarter of a billion customers who placed at least one order on Amazon over the last year. And most of them found what they wanted through search. Every country highlighted on this slide has a separate Amazon site. They have different product catalogs, different indices, and different ranking models powering search relevance. If you come on any of those sites and click on an arrow on the left from the search bar, you will see a list of categories. This list of product categories vary a little bit from country to country, but on average, there are about 30 categories per site. In many instances, we choose to train a separate model for a pair of country and category. Customers searching for books in Japan exhibit completely different search patterns than customers looking for electronics in France. These specialized models end up being much smaller and faster than a single general model would have been. But as a result, we have now over 100 machine learned models in the system. Our choice for the algorithm is standard for search industry. We use gradient boosted trees with pairwise ranking. And as I mentioned, our models are small. Each has only about 200 trees. And while there are over 150 features available, each specialized model is using only about 20 of them. We collect training data from customer actions. For positive examples, we can use products that were clicked, added to cart, or purchased. And for digital categories, Kindle books, Amazon Video, Amazon Music, we have an even better signal consumption. If you buy a can of soda, we have no idea whether you ended up drinking it or not. But if you stream a movie, we know if you watched it, when you watched it, whether you watched the whole movie or just turned it off after 5 minutes. All this information makes for a great signal for training data. For negative labels, we use two types of data points. First is negative scenes. These are products implicitly rejected by the customer. If we show you 10 results and you click on the third, we can view it as a negative vote on the first two. The second is so-called unseen, but in reality, just a random sample from everything. The motivation for including those negatives is that sometimes the results are so bad that the current model will never even show it to the customers, but we still want those negative data points in the training data for the new model. So how do we decide in practice what types of positive targets to use? Short answer is that in general, we should try training on purchases because this is what we want to optimize for in the end. But sometimes it's trickier than that. What is the most clicked item for the query iPhone? No surprise, this is the latest iPhone model, iPhone 7. Lots of customers want to look at its description and read the reviews. But most of them are not really ready to pay $700 for a smartphone. So they end up clicking, but not buying. So what is the most purchased item then for this query? Is it perhaps a cheaper iPhone model? Turns out it is much worse than that. The most purchased item for the query iPhone is an $8 cable. And if we are going to train our model strictly on purchases, this is what we likely are going to see on top. This is completely counterintuitive, and our customers will think that the search is broken if we do this. So for electronics, we end up training on a mix of clicks and purchases as training targets. And here are the results from our final models. The top result is now a cheap, frequently purchased iPhone 5S. And both iPhone 7 that everyone wants to click on and the cable that everyone wants to buy are somewhere on the first page. Well, this trend is most prominent in electronics, where cheap accessories compete with expensive gadgets. We found out that combining clicks and purchases helps in many categories to reconcile different customer intents. Now let's talk about feature selection. We do it in two phases. First phase, we take all features, throw in a few randomly generated useless features in the mix, train a large model, look at feature scores, and choose all features that are scored better than random. On the second stage, we do rounds of backward elimination and forward selection on those features. Algorithms used in the second stage are standard, but for the first stage, we found some very interesting problems. If you used any of the packages for ensemble of trees, GBMs, random forests, XGBoost, you know that they all supply some way of scoring features. Usually these feature scores are based on how the trees are using the features. For example, you could look and sum the number of data points that the feature splits. In this picture, feature A splits a node with 100 data points and a node with 60 data points, so its final score is 160. Exact heuristics vary a lot from package to package. There are lots of them. But they all dance around the same idea. The more nodes a feature splits, the better it is, regardless of what kind of feature it is. Turns out you can run into serious problems with this approach. Here is an illustration. The binary feature telling whether a movie is prime is of tremendous importance for Amazon Video. An average prime member who is searching for blockbuster movies is much more likely to prefer the latest Terminator to the latest X-Men, because Terminator is prime and he can watch it for free. But when we score our features with the traditional method, this extremely important feature gets scored below a random integer valued feature. Here's what's happening. Trees in an ensemble often have some random splits in addition to useful splits. A continuous feature generates lots of candidate splits. A binary feature generates just one candidate split. So when a tree is making an essentially random split, it is much more likely to choose a continuous feature over a binary feature. So in the end of the day, the continuous feature will be chosen much more often in the whole ensemble, even if it's useless, than a very useful binary feature. We need to correct for that. We approached this problem empirically. We created six random features and threw them in the real data and ran an experiment with ensemble of backed trees. The number in the name of the feature corresponds to the number of values in this feature. All these features are random, aka useless, so ideally in the real data, in the real model, they should have all the same low score. But as we suspected, the original scoring method prefers features with more values. While the cardinality of the feature grows exponentially, the score you can see grows linearly, so the dependency is logarithmical. Therefore, the most natural way to bring this scores of the random feature to the same value is to normalize the original score by the entropy of the feature in each node it splits. We have implemented it with back trees. We have open sourced it as a part of tree extra package. It's on GitHub. Download it, use it, it's there. I covered only the basic idea. If you want to know about more implementation details of this normalization, ping me later. And I'm happy to report that after we implemented this normalization, our is prime benefit feature became the most important feature in Amazon Video data. We covered training models for single categories. Now let's see what happens in all product search. If you come to Amazon main website, you can start typing queries right away and you will get a blend of from different categories. For example, if you type a generic query green, You are going to get a green scarf from fashion, some green pots from kitchen, something green and healthy in a jar, and even a book on a recently legalized topic titled Green. So all these results come from different categories and are generated by the ranking models from those respective categories. How do we combine them? The blending process has three main components. First is query category score, which tells how important is this category for this particular query. For common queries, we calculate the score using behavioral information. How often do customers interact with this category after issuing this query? For rare queries, which typically are long, we collect similar statistics for parts of the query. Hunger score is a dynamic score that changes during the blending process. When we don't choose for a while from the same category, its hunger score becomes high. And important categories become hungry faster. And last but not the least, we also look at the original relevance scores from in-category models. Let's see a demo on how blending works. In this example, the query is green, and there are at least three candidate categories, fashion, kitchen, and books. Fashion is the most important. Its query category score is the highest. Kitchen is less important, and books is the least important of the three. In the beginning, hunger scores for all three categories are zero. We start by comparing top results for each category, F1, K1, and V1. Fashion is the most important, so fashion wins, and we place F1 on the top of the blended list. Now, kitchen and books were not chosen, so they become hungry. Kitchen is more important than books, so it becomes hungrier. On the next iteration, we compare F2, K1, and B1, and let's say kitchen wins. We place K1 after F1 in the final list. On the next iteration, we compare F2, K2, B1. Fashion is important. F2 relevance score is high, and fashion got hungry fast, so fashion can win again. And by the next iteration, books became so hungry that finally they can win. And we proceed this way until we get a final list of blended results, where results from each particular category, the order of results from each particular category matches their order generated by the original ranking model from that category. Now let's talk about the generation of the match set. Match set is a set of products that the customer gets after he issues a query. We have two types of products in the match sets. First is standard. These are products whose descriptions match the query after the query understanding team applies all their magic transformations. For a query Zootopia, it could be a movie itself or some movie accessories. We have another types of matches, behavioral matches. These are the products the user interacted with after issuing the query. For this case, it could be movies of a similar genre. But wait a second, isn't there a bit of a chicken and egg problem? In order for the customer to interact with the movie after issuing the query, the movie should be in the match set in the first place, right? So let's see how it happens in practice. Zootopia is just released in cinemas, and it's not available for streaming yet. Customer is searching for Zootopia, and he learns that it's available only on pre-order. But he wants to watch a movie right now, so he searches for a different title. Inside Out. Inside Out is available, so the customer clicks happily. Now, these events happen back-to-back, and our algorithms recognize them as a single session. And they attribute the final click on Inside Out to the original query, Zootopia, through behavioral features. This information gets aggregated over multiple sessions, and by the time Zootopia is released, its match set contains lots of other relevant movies. We can view these results as recommendations on what to watch after Zootopia. We rely a lot on behavioral features, so we often get the question, how do we deal with cold start problems? What is a cold start problem? Suppose a new Harry Potter book is just announced. Really, you don't need to be a machine learning expert to predict that it will be extremely important in the next few days, or more popular than all existing Harry Potter books. But our model doesn't know it yet. And in the beginning, it is possible that it will place it in the bottom of the list. Customers won't like it, and rest assured, our business teams will notice it and let us know very fast that we have a problem. So our internal joke is that the main metric we are optimizing while working on cold start is the number of complaints we receive. So cold start, it turns out, comes in three flavors. Day zero phase is when you don't really have any behavioral data and you rely on other features. Time features are usually very useful. The model can learn that users like watching new movies and reading new books. Day one phase refers to infrastructural delay. We deal with it by propagating fast changes in the data on a special fast track. And if it's been a week and your product is still not ranked where it should be, then something is wrong with your features. Most likely, the feature is not calculated properly for a new product. When we started dealing with cold start, we discussed a lot about how we can build cool, fancy machine learning models to deal with day zero. But then we look at the actual cases that were reported, and we discovered that we can solve them, most of them, by fixing some bugs and features. Let me show you examples. Very simple case, customer share feature. In the numerator, we have the number of customers who bought this particular book. In the denominator, we have the number of customers who bought anything at all on Amazon. Both numbers are a decade over half a year period. This formula looks very reasonable, but it breaks for a new product. If a book appeared just 2 days ago, the numerator will be calculated over the 2 days, but the denominator will be calculated over the whole half a year, unfairly decreasing the value of the feature for the new product and creating a cold start problem. The trivial fix is to calculate the denominator always starting from the day the product appeared on the market. We had a similar problem with the query category score, the score used in all product search for blending. Imagine you are in the moment of the history when the first Harry Potter movie appeared. We need to detect really fast that now the most important category for the query Harry Potter is movies, not books anymore. But because of similar discrepancies of time ranges in the numerator and denominator, it could take us a week to find out. So this problem was a bit more difficult to solve because now the numerator is composed of different products with different start days. So we had to break it into multiple models, calculate a separate formula for each start date and then combine them. But after we solved it, we discovered that our informal metric, number of complaints we get, decreased literally by an order of magnitude. So no cool fancy models were really needed in this case. And the last topic, non-relevant sort. For some common queries, the match sets can be huge. For example, for the query TV, we return over a million of results. In general, it's not a problem as long as you sort by the relevant scores, because our ranking model, hopefully, are smart and can pull relevant results on top. But suppose a customer wants to sort by something else, like customer reviews. This is where the problems begin. If you sort the whole match set by customer reviews, you're going to get a TV mount, a TV cable, even some cloth to wipe your TV with. They all have fantastic customer reviews, but probably that's not what the customer meant to get when he sorted by customer review. We approach this problem by looking at product types in the match set. We calculate the score between the query and the product type. And then when a customer applies a non-relevant sort, we filter the match set, leaving only the up to three most important product types there. So for a query keyboard, this would be keyboard musical instruments or computer input devices. For the query USB, there are several possible devices types. And for TV, thankfully, this is only television. So this concludes my talk. Our search relevance team is mostly located in Bay Area, but we also have groups in Munich, Tokyo, and Beijing. Thank you.